Hi, great to have you. It's been a while, man.
Yeah.
Good?
Yeah.
You're okay? Okay, so for the Rio, it's just 5 days.
I like what you say for the Rio.
Yeah.
Like
Rio Olympics 2016.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For the Rio.
It's been just 5 days.
Yeah,
already we've seen people, you know, talk a lot about Ghana's participation. Kai has come up for discussion. Yes, the vice president has been tweeting. But are we crying too much too early in the competition?
Context is key, isn't it? The most successful African nations are Kenya and South Africa. And just on radio now, I was speaking to a South African journalist who was saying that South Africa in all their history have won 23 medals at the Olympics.
Okay.
And this is South Africa with all the biggest facilities and the best infrastructure in the world. Okay. So far, I was asking him that yesterday, in the early hours of this morning, Michael Phelps beat Chad Leclos.
Yeah.
The background is that Chad Leclos won in the gold medal 20. In 2012
in London, yeah.
In London, and Michael Phelps has avenged to get his 20th, 21st titles, medals, or
yeah,
whatever
yeah.
it was.
Mm-hmm.
Now, interestingly, he was saying that it's not that they are crying too loud, but for them, even they won six the last time, and they are looking at a modest amount of 10. Before somebody says that, why are you comparing us to South Africa? It is worth comparing because they are miles ahead of us. And that is the fact,
okay?
Kenya are the most successful because of their prowess in the track and field, in the cross country, and so on and so forth. Now, let's come to Ghana. We have made, and I said this the last time my interview,
yeah.
that we have made a habit of going for the All-African Games, the Olympics, the Commonwealth Games, and the latest, the World Cup, the Football World Cup.
Yeah.
And we have made it a habit of quibbling and fighting over money instead of fighting over medals,
yeah.
you know, the $3 million and so on. At every Olympics, we go there and we are fighting over stuff. So I've been saying that the fact that these games were smoothly organized and we even got there without talk of per diem, you know, and how much somebody got, how many officials went and so on and so forth, is enough success already. But secondly, is the fact that we have taken a young team for the future.
Yeah.
Some will say, why do you go for the Olympics if you are just going to compete? Sometimes it is the real deal. Even in football, some nations come for the African Cup of Nations, for the World Cup, and they say that this is a young team and we are blooding them for the future.
Yeah.
It happens all the time. In our case, if it is truth, we have a 14-year-old girl called Kaya Forsen, okay, who was representing us in the swimming. If she hadn't gone, a girl called Ophelia Swain would have gone. Ophelia is also a very young girl as well. This is a new generation of talent that we are honing.
Okay.
Look at the facts. The fact is that Sandra Chogedi, who took part in the 63-kilogram judo for
yeah.
us, is the first female judoka we have had. The first judoka we had was in 2012, and it was Emmanuel Nati.
Okay.
So clearly, we are going somewhere with it. Let's not kid ourselves that we are good at something. Countries like South Africa know where their specialties are, and so they don't even bother with the other things, okay?
And play to their strengths.
And play to their strengths. If you look at Great Britain, if you look at their medal targets, that country, I mean, with all their infrastructure, guess how many they are targeting? 48. And they are targeting 48 because of the kind of funding they have.
Yeah.
In Britain, the lottery system funds, so just like we have the Department of National Lotteries mm-hmm. or the National Lotteries Authority here, a fraction of everything you stake in terms of the lotto goes into the Olympic fund. And so there's always a lot of money. But even they don't say that, oh, we have so much money, so we are giving it to every sport.
No. We are realistic with the ambition.
Yes.
Okay.
For certain sports, they target and go so on and so forth. So I will be one of those who will say that we are crying too early that we have not won anything. Because maybe it's actually quite likely that we will not win anything.
Anything at all.
Yeah.
The other side to this conversation, Gary, has been about the crop of people we've sent and the niggling fact that none of these individuals are homegrown, home-based,
yeah.
local people. What's the problem here? Is it that we don't have the kind of infrastructure and the money and the people to train for the Olympics? Is that it?
What's the greatest Olympic nation when it comes to the sprints? Name the top three.
But Jamaica, United States.
Okay, so Jamaica and United States.
Yeah.
The United States are homegrown because, well, they have all the colleges there. They have all the best athletic programs there, and they do it there.
Mm-hmm.
Jamaica, where did the best Jamaicans train? In the United States.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean that they don't have facilities in their country, but when they discover the likes of Usain Bolt, who was discovered at 15 in their very highly patronized Coca-Cola sponsored athletics meet, almost always they fly them out en masse. to the United States for polishing. And that is what we do here. Most of our athletes, there are 16 of them, were born in Ghana, and some grew up in Ghana, but they have gone on scholarships. Some also were born outside the country. Mm-hmm. Because of their Ghanaian parentage, they simply went to school there. It is not a bad thing. Go to football. How many of our Black Stars players, since 2002, mm-hmm. the African Cup of Nations, when we fielded players like Isaac Bwachi and others, did we last field a local 11 or even 8 players of our team being local 11? It's not that our local league is not good. It is the simple fact of the matter that the best polishing schools in football mm-hmm. are in Europe and in America. So if our local talents are there, it's not that we don't have a great, you know, system or anything. It's just that the best facilities are outside the country. And finally, Margaret Simpson, one of the greatest of our athletes, yeah. she was based in Mauritius. Ignatius Geza was based in the Netherlands. It is what it is.
Okay. Gary, I think I've had enough for this analysis, yeah. but there's more you have for us in sports.
Yeah, sure. So
what you got?
Well, apart from the Olympics, we are looking at some of the other sports today, namely boxing. You know, Isaac Dogbe has been getting a lot of headlines mm-hmm. for Ghana, and we are looking at a title that probably he can win. But first of all, Martha Bissa takes the headlines. When was the last time you heard of her?
Been a while, and I only wonder why she was not in all of this.
Well, you know, she didn't qualify, yeah. and it became, but she didn't just make the team. And so we are looking at something good that is happening to her. She's got a scholarship in the United States.
Oh, we thank God for that.
Ah, yeah.
That means progress, isn't it?
Well, it depends on the interview we have, whether God has anything to do with it.
Okay, let's see. Let's see how that goes.
Right, thank you for joining us for the main edition of the Sport. Francis took the side dish. I'll give you the main course. Today, we are talking Martha Bissa, the athlete who made Ghana proud by taking part in Nanjing in the Youth Olympics and actually won gold. There's been a lot of talk in the past 2 years about what to do with her raw talent. There's been a lot of fights, if you can put it that way, between the Ghana Athletics Authority and several other stakeholders, including her parents and other trainers, who could not decide whether to keep her here or whether to go to schools in the United States. We have learned in the last 24 hours that George Lutrot, a former Ghana Athletics Association president, has secured a scholarship for the talented young lady to study and train in the United States. But there's a question of politics. Is it an indictment on the part of the Ghana Athletics Authority? And on the phone with us is Bawa Fuseni, a former general secretary of the GAA, to give us some perspective on the matter. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Gary.
Bawa, you are part of that GAA administration that set in motion a great program to bring more youth into the system. Martha Bissa seems to be the one that got away. The politics of the matter are that the current administration have always said that they are looking for the best interest of the talented athlete. However, it is taking a former GAA president to put her in a school. What does this say about the current administration?
Thank you very much for this question. I don't think that it's as such much about the current administration. Dr. Joel Lutros, as you rightly mentioned, he was a former chairman, and he has been helping athletes, not now, but he has been helping athletes when he was the chairman, and when he even left the scene, he was still helping athletes. So it is good. We should recommend him for doing such a wonderful thing for Martha Bissa. I think that is the right thing, in the right direction. We should recommend him for doing such a wonderful thing for the young lady. Her stories have always been some negative stories in the media. That does not order well for her development. And this time around, this story is a positive story for her. And if really she really gets to the United States of America, it will change her lifetime. It will change her life for better. It will encourage her to do more for his athletic career and to even have an education career for herself. So that is a good thing. For me, it's a good thing what Dr. John Lutrell have done for her, and he should continue to do that, not for Martha Bissa. If he can do that for other athletes, and if any other person who also loves athletics can also do that for any other athlete, that will help grow the athletics in Ghana.
But I appreciate your attempts at being very diplomatic, and it's very, very commendable. However, the facts of the matter are that Martha Bissa and the people behind her have been in serious problems with the Ghana Athletics Association for many reasons that we have spoken on this show many, many times. And the impression has been created that if she doesn't, you know, go on the side of the current GAA administration, she will not progress in life. Indeed, in the Facebook comments that George Lutros wrote to announce this scholarship for Martha Bisa, he made a clearly snide remark aimed at the GAA administration and, you know, basically said that he has done what Napoleon could not do. So we can't run away from the politics.
Yes, I don't want to get into the politics because I happened to send Martha Bisa to the Nigerian Olympics. Before the Nigerian Olympics, who knew Martha Bisa? People got to know Martha Bisa after the Nigerian Youth Olympics, and who sent her there. I didn't want to get into that banter with who did what and who didn't do what. But what we should focus now on her development and what Dr. Lutros is doing currently for her now. I know a lot about the Martha Bisa issue. I just decided to keep quiet over it because there were so many maligning and lies and half-truths about her. But you just try to focus on what currently is happening, positively happening to her now, so that we're able to push it through. But I just want to know who is, if he's going, that is good for Ghana Athletics, that is good for Dr. Lutros, that is good for Martha Bisa. I'm just going to wish her well and encourage Dr. Lutro to continue doing that, and any other person who can also help in that list to do that. He's not the first one to do that, and I hope he will not be the last person to do it. Let's just put the politics aside and just focus on what is possibly happening to her right now.
Right. Clarion call well noted. Baba Fuseni is a former GAA General Secretary speaking to us on the Martha Bisa situation. You can get more on this story about the scholarship she's copped for herself at myjoyonline.com. Thank you, Baba. To more, and this time we do boxing. Now, Isaac Dogbe is a name that we have heard so much about this year. Let's remind ourselves of what he's been able to do. He was in the studios last with us, together with Isaac Kakembo, who promised to chain him and rather left Ghana beaten after, well, 5-6 rounds. And Isaac Dogbe is looking ahead to securing a world title, but we understand that something is up and is going to happen in the next couple of weeks. So that is Isaac Dogbe there in your short. Dogbe, one of the most promising talents coming out of Ghana in terms of boxing, and we understand that on the 26th of August he will be vying for a title, but it's a different sort of title really, and it will be against Neil John Tabanao. In studio with me is Yofi Boham, a member of the promotions committee of the Ghana Boxing Authority. Thank you very much for joining us.
You're welcome.
Yes, first of all, before I go into the meat of the matter, the promotions committee is something new. What is your job there, and what is the portfolio for?
Oh, the promotions committee of the GBA. Oh, it's the committee that that sanctions fights, that approves fights. When a bill is presented, it presented to the chairman of the committee. We meet and scrutinize the bouts on the night. And if all the fighters are approved, then we approve the fight. So whenever fights are coming on, you see that there should be a remark that's sanctioned by the Ghana Boxing Authority. Then it means it's gone through
the procedure and everything. Right, fantastic. Right. So on the 26th of August, you have sanctioned the fight between Isaac Dogbe and Neil Tabanao also coming on. What is it going to be? And this belt is something I haven't seen before. It says the WBC World Youth Champion. It's not something we've seen a lot in Ghana.
You're right. This is the first time such a belt is to be vied for in Ghana. The first one, which happened some 3-4 years ago, was for the interim title, and it was a fiasco.
Mm.
But now this is the proper youth world championship being vied for between a Ghanaian and a Filipino.
Yeah.
It's for those who are under 24, that is 23 years 11 months
and below.
Yes, and below. So they qualify for this championship. Already Dogbe is the holder of the WBO African featherweight title. Tabanao also holds the Oceanic version. So there is going to be a unification bout between the two.
Yeah.
The winner takes the two belts.
Okay.
And I suggested and brought in the third belt, which is a vacant, which is vacant at the moment.
Okay.
And it's from no boxing body than the WBC. They are so happy to bring this to us for it to be right for, because Azuma Nelson, the professor, was a WBC champion for 15 good years.
Yeah.
And we are expecting Dogbe to step into his shoes.
Into his shoes as well. Now, Dogbe, he's been on this show a couple of times, and I've always asked him when he's going to be fighting for that world title, because Ghana is hungry for a world champion. How does this factor into the plans for him to become a world champion? Or that is to say, if he wins this world youth one, what then happens?
You're really right. Everyone is yearning to see a world champion.
Yeah.
A worthy world champion, not that's right. So Dogbe right now is ranked 37 with the WBC.
Yeah.
Well, the WBO, he is 12. Tabanao is 15. Tabanao, after winning the Oceanic, jumped to the 15th position. Dogbe was 12, was 13, and he's gone to 12.
Yeah.
So very, 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 very commendable there. Anyone who wins the upcoming fight will definitely jump to climb to the first five, the top five. Now with the WBC, he is ranked 37, and fighting for the Youth World Championship. If he wins, he gets to the top 10.
Oh,
or very close to the top 10. And within the top 10, you know, you can fight for the world title.
Yeah.
Depending on how your handlers negotiate. Because if you are chosen within the top 10, that is a voluntary defense by the champion.
Yeah.
He can choose to choose anyone. He will make sure he chooses someone whom he can beat.
Sure.
And until he gets to number one, which will be a long journey. Number one becomes a mandatory challenger, but that it's always fought by setting up a time. Now, when he fights and wins this, and we are lucky for him to jump up to the top 10, there you will have to do everything under the sun
to
make sure he wins. And this is what the head of state, His Excellency John Mahama, has put across.
Okay.
Yes, for him to fight with his praying, even if we get the chance, so that that opportunity will be used to open
The new boxing
gym in Accra. Yes.
All right.
I've started communication about that.
Okay.
Ahead of the 26th fight.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for your time, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Yofi Buham, who is one of the promotions committee members of the Ghana Boxing Authority. That fight is on the 26th, and it's going to be between Isaac the Royal Storm Dogbe and Neil John Tabanao, and it's going to be in Accra. Thank you very much for your time on this sport. It's been quite extended, and you can get more on the Olympics and everything else we've discussed on myjoyonline.com. I'm Gary R. Smith. Later.